Hi, welcome back. Continuing on the theme of market timing, I'd like to focus in this session on two aspects of market timing. One is what I call mean reversion. We assume that markets revert back to historic norms. And the second is using macroeconomic variables to predict future directions for the equity market. So let's start with mean reversion. Mean reversion is built on the presumption that there is a normal range at which assets should trade at, and if you deviate from that normal range, either above or below it, then assets are mispriced. So with stocks, for instance, one commonly used mechanism is to look at the P/E ratio. And if stocks are collectively trading at P/E ratio is much higher than a normal P/E, and we leave that undefined for the moment, they're overvalued. If they're trading well below that normal P/E, they're undervalued. With T-bonds or with bonds in general, the normal range is usually specified in terms of interest rates. We assume that there is some normal interest rate, a normal T-bond rate, and if the T-bond rate is below that norm, it's going to revert back up to that norm, and if the T-bond rate is above that norm, it's going to revert back down. So all of these approaches that we're going to talk about in the next few pages are built on the presumption that things revert back to the norm. Now, before I look at the results, though, recognize that many of the results I'm going to give you are going to come from the U.S. equity markets from the second half of the 20th century going into the first decade of this century. You're saying, so what? The second half of the last century was a fairly unique one because if you look at the U.S. economy in that period, it dominated the global economy. It was the ultimate mature economy. So many of the lessons you might be getting out of this might be the wrong lessons for the next 50 or 100 years as markets become more globalized and there is no dominant local economy anymore. But given that history again, let's start looking at the data. Let's start by asking, is there a normal P/E ratio? To answer that question, here's what I did. I graphed out the P/E ratio for the S&P 500 going all the way back to 1960. And you can see the P/E ratios, there are the 1960s, then you see the 1970s P/E ratios collapse. They're in the single digits. Then you see the great bull market, P/E ratios peak around 1999-2000. That's the peak of the dot-com boom. And then they kind of, mellow out, if that's the right word, over the last decade, between 10, 15. And if you look at 2012, 2013, P/E ratios for the S&P 500 were back to about 15, 16. Now the question is that a high number? Is that a low number? You can already see one of the problems with having a normal range. It depends on what time period of history I look at. I could argue, for instance, with a P/E ratio of 16, which is a P/E ratio in June of 2013, that a P/E ratio of 16 is high relative to what the P/E ratio used to be in the 1970s. I could tell you stocks are cheap because the P/E ratio of 16 is still lower than the P/E ratio in the late 90s. So I can pick and choose slices of history to compare myself to and tell you any story I want. If you look at the P/E ratio across the 52 years, the median P/E ratio for U.S. stocks is about 15, 16. You could perhaps use that median and argue that based on that median P/E ratio, stocks don't look either overvalued or undervalued today. But normal is very much in the eye of the beholder because it depends on the period of history you look at. It might also depend on how you compute P/E ratios. You're saying, what do you mean by that? Price-earnings ratio, there's a numerator, which is the market value of equity, and the denominator, of course, is the aggregate earnings made by stocks. And we know that aggregate earnings swing over time. During recession years, those numbers can drop off. What that also means is that P/E ratios can look abnormally high during recessions, not because stocks are overvalued, but because earnings have dropped down because of the recession. So one solution to this problem is to normalize the earnings, take an average earnings over time. And there are different ways of doing this. One, for instance, is take the average earnings over 5 or 10 years and use that as the denominator. Another approach, actually, which Shiller developed over a few years ago, was to take the inflation effect out. Because you have earnings going up only because of inflation, it's less attractive than earnings going up because of operating growth, because you're selling more stuff. So you see the graph for regular P, you see the graph for real P, where I've taken out inflation, and you see the purple number. That's actually my normalized real P, where I've taken both the inflation-adjusted earnings and averaged them out across time. This is a number that is tracked by some analysts, and again, there's a range that they develop around this normalized real P. And normalized real P, for instance, the rules of thumb I've seen floating around are, when it's, the normalized number is between 14 and 16, so it's higher than 16, you have stocks being overvalued. And if it's below 14, then stocks are undervalued. We talked about the PE ratio in June of 2013. People using normalized PE have concluded that the normalized PE in June of 2013 is about 23, which is well above that 16 upper end of the range. So based on that comparison, stocks in June of 2013 look overvalued. And of course, what follows then is if you believe that, then you're going to have a bad year or a bad period for stocks following. So that's assuming that stocks have a normalized, normal PE at which they trade at. The weakness of this entire analysis, of course, is it doesn't factor in the level of interest rates that you face. It's true stocks in 2013 trade at 16, 17 times earnings, which is the upper end of that normalized range. But at the same time, T-bond rates in 2013 were 1.5%, 2%, far lower than they were historically, which would suggest that stocks should trade at a higher P/E ratio. That's, I think, what you miss when you focus on a purely normalized P/E ratio and say stocks look overvalued, undervalued based on that comparison. So let's turn to interest rates. Is there a normal range of interest rates? What I mean by that is I said in June of 2013, the T-bond rate in the U.S. was 2.15%. And a story that's floating around, it's a pretty strongly, you know, conveyed story, is there is a normal range for the T-bond rate. It should be much higher. It should be 3%, 4%. 2.15% is too low. If you buy into that story, you know what follows. Interest rates are more likely to go up in the next period than come down. There's some basis for an argument that there's a normal range of interest rates, and you can see that by in the table that you see in this particular page, where basically what I've done is I've taken two time periods of history, 1900 to 1970 and 1971 through 2000. I've classified based on the T-bill rate, and I'm focusing on the short-term rates here. We'll talk about long-term rates in a minute. I've classified T-bill rates into more than 4.4%, between 3.25 and 4.4%, and less than 3.25%. Okay. And then I've looked at what the yield curve looks like given the level of the T-bill rate. And you can see that when T-bill rates are low, then the yield curve is upward sloping. So when T-bill rates are less than 3.25%, you have an upward sloping yield curve. When you have really high short-term rates, you're far more likely to see a downward sloping yield curve. Updating that study to 1971 through 2010, if T-bill rates were greater than 8%, which has happened about 8 times, you have four upward, the relationship has become a lot weaker since 71. So if you tell me the level of short-term rates, it's much more difficult for me to predict the slope of the yield curve now than it used to be between 1900 and 1970. But let's ask a different question. If you know the T-bond rate today, or you know the change in the T-bond rate over the last year, does it help you predict the interest rate in the next period? So to answer that question, here's what I did. I took the change in the T-bond rate every year from 1970 to 95, and I looked at the level of rates at the end of the previous year. So if you tell me what the rate is today, can I predict what the change will be in the next period? So the way to read this graph is you see a negative coefficient here. What that effectively means is for every 1% higher my interest rate is right now, the next period my interest rate is more likely to drop by 0.1456%. In other words, the higher my interest rates, the more likely it is that I'm going to see a drop in interest rates in the next period. The lower my interest rate, the more likely it is that I'm going to see an increase in interest rates in the following period. So that's a cautionary note. If you're in June of 2013, looking at a 2.15% rate, which is a really low rate, you're more likely to see an increase in interest rates next period, if you look at based on history, than a decrease in interest rates. So it is suggestive that at least over this time period, there was some degree of mean reversion, that interest rates, when they were high, were more likely to come down. When they were low, were more likely to go up. Now, the third kind of variation in this theme is to focus on macroeconomic fundamentals. And the story here is a simple one. After all, stock markets are supposed to reflect what's happening in the overall economy. So there should be a relationship between macroeconomic variables like interest rates and inflation and real economic growth and what happens in stock prices. And there are two ways in which you might use macro variables to try to time markets. One is to get a sense of, if you know what's happened to a macro variable, interest rates or GDP growth over the last period, can you give me a better sense of what's going to happen to stocks over the next period? So that's one relationship we can look at. The other is you might get ahead of the game and see if you can predict changes in the macro variables. Can you predict changes in inflation in the next year? Changes in interest rates in the next year, changes in real economic growth in the next year. Because presumably if you can predict those changes, you should at least get a sense of what the market will do if those things happen. So let's take macroeconomic variables and think about rules of thumb that have developed over time built around macroeconomic variables. For instance, I've heard stories told that it's best to buy stocks when T-bill rates are low, or when T-bond rates have dropped, or when GNP growth is strong. They're all stories, and the question is there any basis to these stories that you see floating around, built around macroeconomic variables? To try to answer that, I did a few very simple tests. Here's the first one I tried. I looked at the level of T-bill rates, or the change in the T-bill rate in a period, and asked, does that tell me what the stock market will do in the next year? So the way to read this table is, let's say you're in a year and T-bill rates have dropped by 1%, or by more than 1% over the last year. So interest rates have come down a lot. That's a good thing, right? Let's see what happened to stocks in the next period. Well, the annual return in the next period for stocks was 9.65%, and 66.67% of the time, 8 out of the 12 years, stocks went up. You're saying that's pretty good? But let's take the other end. Let's say T-bill rates over the last year went up by 1%. That's usually considered a bad sign. Interest rates have gone up in the next year. My stock returns 11.78%, actually higher than the returns that I've made after a drop in interest rates, and stock prices go up 10 out of the 15 years, exactly the same percentage of the time as when interest rates drop by more than 1%. So if you look across this table, there's little discernible relationship between what happened to interest rates last year and what will happen to stock prices next year. So if you have people telling you that interest rates have gone down, therefore this is a good time to invest in stocks, well, that might or might not be true, but history itself doesn't suggest any reason to be optimistic or more optimistic about stock prices for the next year just because interest rates have come down over the last year. So when you look at these studies that are based on interest rates, here's a couple of optimistic notes. A study in 1988 looked at a strategy of investing, of switching from stock to cash, and based on the level of the T-bill rates. If T-bill rates were high, you switched into cash. If T-bill rates were low, you switched back into stock. And this study claimed that switching strategy would have generated about 2% more in excess returns for an actively managed portfolio. Now, as a follow-up study, though, notes a few caveats. One is it notes that almost all of that correlation found in the earlier study came from the 1950 to 75 time period. That post-75, the level of interest rates has very little predictive power about what will happen to stock prices. Just because T-bill rates are high or low today tells you nothing about what stock prices will do in the next period. They found that stock, and in fact, when they did find a relationship between the short-term interest rates and stock prices, it was more in the durable goods sector and with smaller companies than with the entire market. So bottom line, knowing what's happened to interest rates in the recent past doesn't seem to give you a leg up in predicting what will happen to stocks over the foreseeable future. So here's the second thing I tried. I've been told that low interest rates are good for stock prices, and T-bond rates are low, stocks should do much better. To answer that question, here's what I did. I went back over a long time period. I took the level of the T-bond rate at the end of each year, and I looked at the stock returns over the next year. I wanted to see whether periods where T-bond rates were low were followed by high returns, and conversely, when periods with T-bond rates were high were followed by low returns. Well, the answer is there is a weak relationship. It's a positive relationship. Higher T-bond rates historically, though, have gone with higher stock returns, not lower stock returns. Lower T-bond rates have gone with lower stock returns. So if there's a story out there about the level of interest rates and stock prices, the evidence actually suggests the opposite. That just because interest rates are high right now doesn't make stocks a bad investment. And just because interest rates are low right now doesn't make stocks a good investment. Okay. There's a variation on this story, though, where rather than just look at the T-bond rate, people look at the earnings yield, which is the earnings to price ratio. Think of that as the return you're making on stocks. So what they do is they compare the earnings yield to the T-bond rate, and here's how the story goes. When the earnings yield is high relative to the T-bond rate, stocks are a good buy. Stocks are cheap. When the earnings yield is low relative to the T-bond rates, stocks are expensive. Let's see if it's true. So here's what I did. I took a long period of history and I broke the sample down into six groups based on the difference between the earnings yield and the T-bond rate. So let's take the first group. What is that telling me? I looked at all the years where the earnings yield was 2% or more higher than the T-bond rate. So basically, that's if I buy into the conventional wisdom, stocks are cheap, right? I should be buying stocks. Well, the average return that I've made wasn't bad, 11.91%. But let's go to a period where the earnings yield is actually lower than the T-bond rate by 1%, or between 0 and 1%. Happened in 6 years. Stock return in the following year was 11.21%, almost the same as it was when the earnings yield was 2% higher than the T-bond rate. It's true that at the extreme, when the earnings yield is more than 2% below the T-bond rate, stocks do worse. So maybe if there's a signal here, it's when you get the extreme movement of the earnings yield falling well below the T-bond rate. The rest of the table, it's actually very difficult to discern a pattern between the difference in the earnings yield and the T-bond rate and what happens to stock prices in the next period. So if you know what the earnings to price ratio is right now, the T-bond rate is right now, and you can compute this difference, compute the difference, but don't do anything rash. History doesn't suggest that this is a good predictor of what's going to happen to stock prices in the next period. The third variable I looked at was economic cycles. I looked at GDP growth and I looked at stock returns. Again, the conventional story is when GDP growth is high, stock prices should go up, and when the economy is doing badly, stock prices should go down. Well, let's see if that's true. Again, I broke down the time periods into periods where GDP annual growth was greater than 5%, from really good economies to really bad economies. And here's what I did to follow up. I said, let's assume last year was a really good year for the economy. The economy grew 5%. What's the return I could make in the next year? You're saying, why not look at the return in the same year? Well, I wouldn't have known that the economy was going to do well at the start of the year. So I had to wait till the end of the year to find out that the economy was doing well. If I invest in the following year, my annual return is about 10.04%. But you know what? If I take in really bad years for the economy, there were 17 years where GDP growth was actually less than zero. The economy was in a recession. The stock return I'd have made in the year after the recession would have been 15.11%. Again, what you're finding is a very weak relationship. If there is one, maybe an inverse relationship between economic growth and stock prices. What is the bottom line here? Macroeconomic variables might be contemporaneously correlated with stock returns. In other words, really good economic growth might go with really good stock returns in the same year. But knowing what the macroeconomic variable looks like this year might not be a good predictor of future growth, because markets already built it in. In fact, markets might become too optimistic after periods of high economic growth, which might explain why the returns are not as good. So in summary, in this session, we looked at ways of predicting what the market will do by either assuming mean reversion, where stock prices revert back to norms, interest rates revert back to norms, and there is some evidence of mean reversion, but not strong enough for you to make a lot of money on it. And we also looked at macroeconomic variables, interest rates and GDP growth, to look to see if there's a relationship between what that variable does this year and what stock prices are next year. And the bottom line conclusion is there's not much of a relationship. It's difficult to make money off macroeconomic variables because there seems to be little correlation between what that variable does this year and the stock returns in the following year. But there's no harm trying. I've just looked at a subset of macroeconomic variables. Maybe there are more obscure macroeconomic variables that I haven't looked at that are good predictors of stock returns. Go out and try. Maybe you can find one. Thank you very much for listening.